just so exciting and so, so thrilling to read about and to see how they're working out. As I mentioned to you last week, if you read any commentaries of other preachers or teachers or professors, whatever you want to call them in the body of Christ, you'll notice that they have a different viewpoint of the Passion Week. And the viewpoint I have is not the one that's normally held by everyone, by tradition. And as I said, we'll get into that in particular, but I'm giving you little excerpts of it as we move along. Now, as the Passion Week marches on, it's moving to that infamous goal, and you know what it is, and that is, of course, the cross and the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, various incidents occurred. Matthew speaks about them. Mark speaks about them. Luke speaks about them. Even John in the Gospel speaks about them. But in particular, there was one incident actually coupled with, and although it doesn't seem that way in reading the scripture, it seems to be coupled with, of course, the cleansing of the temple that we studied last week. And this particular incident displayed an unusual side of Jesus' ministry on this earth. And of course, his overwhelming ministry is a ministry of grace. It's a ministry of love. The Lord Jesus came to save sinners such as you and I. Even the Apostle Paul said to him, he is chief of sinners, and Jesus saved him. But on two occasions, last week and this week here, God the Son didn't bring mercy and grace. He brought judgment from the Lord. And this is an important study, as we're going to see. Now, to help us understand it, we're going to watch the visual Bible. And of course, if you're new here to that, this is simply the gospel in the New International Version enacted or dramatized for us. So it helps us out to understand perhaps the perspective of it. Let's watch right now.
And he went out of the city into Bethany, where he spent the night. As he was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to it, but found nothing on it except leaves. Then he said to it,
"May never bear fruit again."
Immediately the tree withered. When the disciples saw this, they were amazed.
"How did the fig tree wither so quickly?"
they asked. Jesus replied,
"I tell you the truth. If you have faith and do not doubt, not only can you do what was done to the fig tree, but also you can say to this mountain, 'Go throw yourself into the sea,' and it will be done. If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer."
Okay, that's our short section. Let's pray. Father, open this word to us today. May we apply it, understand it. May we put it into perspective, and may we indeed understand the fullness of the Word of God, particularly the verbal inspiration of the Word of God as we study it, as it opens for us perhaps new and more in-depth studies and understanding. Well, above all, Lord, anyone listening today who doesn't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, we pray for them that you will open their hearts to receive Jesus Christ as the Lord and Master, that they might enter into eternal life. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. As we move along here, the title for today's message is, again, the very simple thing, nothing but leaves. How devastating it was on that day, if you think about it, when the Lord came in contact with a fruit tree and he found leaves on it, but looking for the fruit, there was nothing there at all. So we're going to look at three things in my message. We're going to look at the Lord's call in verses 18 and 19, and then the second part, the Lord's curse, and ultimately the Lord's comment as we go through. Now Matthew tells us that during the journey that Jesus made on the Passion Week, he came from the suburbs of Jerusalem, and that was Bethany, the town, chapter 21, verse 17. Jesus and the disciples arose early, and they headed back into Jerusalem. If you notice on the screen it was enacted, it showed that the disciples were lying around on the ground out there, and that's probably pretty accurate. You know, the texts tell us that they met in Bethany with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, but they only met for supper time or a dinner celebration. They didn't stay with them. I don't know about you, you know, there were 12 disciples and there was the Lord Jesus, so how many of us can house 13 people in our home, right? You know, there usually isn't that kind of room. But even more so, remember, this was the Passover, and everyone from all over was coming. So the place was crowded, the inns were taken, every place that rented a home or a place to stay. So people stayed out in the countryside, and of course they camped all around, as did our disciples as well. Now, Jesus and the disciples, as they arose early that morning from Bethany, they were going back to Jerusalem. And although the time seems confusing to people, let me say this. I believe this event, as I alluded to a moment ago, preceded the cleansing of the temple. So in other words, the day of the cleansing of the temple was the same time as they were coming from Bethany for that event. And the Lord Jesus and his disciples came upon this fig tree. So put that in perspective. Now this was most likely on Sunday morning, and I'll explain more about that later. Bethany was about 2 miles outside of Jerusalem, and the early morning walk, of course, brought them probably through Bethpage to get into Jerusalem. And we'll see what that means in a moment here. But it appeared as they walked, Jesus looked, and in the distance he saw a fig tree that was full of leaves, was completely blooming with leaves. And that was very important because it was a promising sign not only of spring, but the early first crop of figs that would be in and under that. So let's read verses 18 and 19 and see what we discover. Early in the morning, as Jesus was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to it, but he found on it nothing except leaves. Now, this is an important note because during the time of Jesus, there were two types of fig trees. There was one fig tree that bore figs 3 times a year, early in the spring, in the summer, and then in late fall. And sometimes those late fall figs actually stayed on the tree all the way into springtime. But nonetheless, Isaiah talks about that in Isaiah 28 verse 4, and he speaks about a fig that is ripe for harvest on the trees. Now, this 3 times a year tree is apparently the one that was planted most often. And the first was before the larger regular fig that came for the summer crop that was harvested. Now this type of fig, of course, came on the tree before the leaves. And once the figs came on, then the leaves came out and covered them, but the sign that there were figs was that there were leaves. And so when the Lord and the disciples from a distance looked in there, and they saw a fig tree by the road, they went up to it and began to examine underneath the leaves to see if they could find these early figs. These early figs, I'm told, were very sweet and they were very delicious. And so that would have provided a good breakfast for a hungry person. And as it says here, the Lord was hungry. Now, as I said, they were coming from Bethany and they probably had to travel through Bethpage. And guess what? The name Bethpage means house of the early fig. So all these things seem to fit in with that particular thing. Now this is a good point to make some application and comment on the Lord Jesus and of course the gospel text as well. Number one, it says Jesus was hungry. No, you might go over that very quickly, but I always stop on things like that, and I start to think about that, because really, what did this tell us? It told us that Jesus was a real human being. He was the infinite God-man, yes, but he was a real human being, and like all of us, he experienced the sinless limitations of our human nature. Now, contrary to Gnostic teachings and other fanciful ideas, the Lord Jesus was not some kind of alien being that was walking on the earth. He wasn't disguised as a ghostly apparition. God the Father had determined that God the Son would become a human being, and he did. And as a result of that, he could sympathize with all the ailments of human experience and physical experiences that we have daily. So think about that. When we pray to Jesus, how important it is, we know we can express our weaknesses in our life, our physical needs, surgeries that we're going through, and all different kinds of things, and know that Jesus Christ experienced humanity personally and experiential. God the Son knows that, and all that we face, he can enter into that. So our Savior faced that. I look through the scriptures and you can see the other areas where Jesus' humanity was absolutely proved. For instance, in John 18, Jesus experienced thirst. In Matthew 4:6, he experienced weariness. In John 11:36, he experienced the emotion of love. Goes on, a broken heart, John 11:35. Compassion, Mark 9:36. Even human temptations, Hebrews 4:15. But the difference between him and us is that he experienced them without sin. And that's important too. But nonetheless, these are all absolute characteristics of full humanity. Jesus was not 50% man and 50% God. Some have said that. He was 100% a human being and 100% God. Now we can't explain or understand these things, but nonetheless. But Hebrews 4:15 makes it clear that the temptations Jesus experienced were without sin. We call that in theology the impeccability of Christ. That means that Jesus could not sin, not that he would not sin, but he could not sin because of who he is. Indeed, he is our human brother, but indeed, he is our God. Now, there's a second thing we can note here, and that is that there was never a moment in the life of the Lord Jesus when he looked around him and saw and experienced the things of life, that he didn't think of using it as an illustration to those around him of the greatness of God. Isn't that wonderful that he did that? Here he found this fig tree, and he was going to use this for an illustration, teaching, an example of eternal things. And you know, that's a good lesson point for you and me too, because as believers in Christ, we should be looking around every day, all through our lives, of illustrations and examples that we can use of what we go through or what we see to talk to other people about the greatness and the goodness of God. In fact, you know, God commanded Israel to do that years ago. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 29, it says, "These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. You are to impress them on your children." How are you to do that? The father and mother to talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down, that is, in the evening hour, and when you get up in the morning hour. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads and write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. So the Lord Jesus was just fulfilling the ultimate commandment of his father to an Israelite to do these very things. And you and I today, just think about that, we are to use it as well. Every facet of my life, your life experience, is to be used to honor, to promote, and of course teach God's truth. So let's make some practical application. You think about it. How well are you doing? Do you employ this method of sharing the gospel? You know, I'm very thankful that I learned that at an early age when my five children were very young. And Ursula and I, we did this all through our lives. Everywhere we went, whether it was morning devotions or something like that, we tried to apply the things we went through in life to show them God. Even when mom and dad had an argument, even when mom and dad failed to do what God told us to do, we explained it to the children. We were sinners, but we explained that God forgives us and he puts us back on our feet, and we can walk forward with God. Isn't that wonderful? You know, sometimes children are raised in Christian homes where they never see or know about the failure of mom and dad. And they know that they are sinners, and they say, I can never be a good Christian. So they turn away from the faith because they have never seen the frailty of their mom and dad. So whether you're a parent or a grandparent, don't fail to show your children that you're a sinner and that you have the forgiveness of God and that you can go on and continue on with Him. So it's important. Jesus was showing this very thing. And you know, this is something God commands even a New Testament believer, because all you have to do is go to the book of Matthew 28, the closing of the gospel. It says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations. Some people think that was a command to the disciples and not to everyday believers. No, it was a command to all Christians everywhere. And the word go in the original Greek means as you are going. In your everyday life, in everything you're doing and thinking. Vic was talking to me earlier this morning about what does it mean to pray in the Spirit. What it means is just this. Everything you do, make sure God is a part of it. Make sure the Holy Spirit is able to be speaking to your heart about all the things that are going on. So as you're going about your daily life, make disciples, share the gospel with all nations and all people. And ask God to enlighten you and empower your mind in the things and circumstances around you for that very purpose there. And then apply it to life's experiences. All right. Now, how disappointing it must have been for the Lord and His disciples to find that although the tree had all these leaves on it, this fig tree, and it had advertised it was fruitful, but when they got up to the tree and looked on it, there wasn't a single piece of fruit anywhere on the tree. It's not that it was already harvested or somebody picked it. There was nothing there to show its life-giving sustenance for which it was created. Now think about that. That's important because Genesis 1:29 says, then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit on it with seed. And what is it for? It's for your food. Isn't that amazing? Think about that. God created fruit trees for our physical enjoyment while nourishing us for our own physical survival. And so then the true purpose of God was that this tree was to bear its fruit, but it wasn't fulfilling what God had commanded it to do. You know, when you think about trees in general, I was thinking something else about that. Around my home in Grand Junction, I have a big oak tree and I have big pine trees in the back. All around we are huge trees. And you know what, when it gets to 100, 105 in the summer or something, it's always cool at our house. And you know why that is? Because the trees are our evaporator cooler. Yeah, I have an evaporator cooler like a lot of people do, and it works great. But let me tell you, those trees work great too, because that's God's evaporator cooler. Think about this. Trees cool the air through two simultaneous processes. It's called evaporation and transpiration. And what this is that the tree, of course, draws in carbon dioxide, which we exhale, and the tree produces oxygen, and in the process, it gives off moisture into the air. You know, one huge oak tree, I was reading about it this week, one huge oak tree can give into the air 150,000 gallons of water a year. Is that amazing when you think about that? One fruit tree can do that. I mean, one big oak tree. So that's why it's cool when you get around trees. And normally on a hot summer's day, if you have a big oak tree with lots of leaves, you'll discover that the temperature is usually at least 15 degrees cooler at that tree than if you walk away from that tree and go into the air. So God's planned that. That's His evaporator cooler, but also the fruit to sustain us here. Now, likewise, God was teaching, even Jesus, and the Word of God does for us, that as this tree was to abundantly produce fruit, which it was not doing, guess what? You as a believer in Christ are called to abundantly produce fruit too. Not some of us, not just the pastor, not just the elders and deacons of a church or the missionaries on the field. All believers, if you've come to know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are to produce fruit. And of course, the fruit is varied in different kinds nonetheless. God gave you spiritual life, and then he gave you spiritual gifts. We studied the spiritual gifts of the believer. Do you know every believer has at least one spiritual gift? And many of us have more, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 different spiritual gifts. And guess what? The fruit on a fruit tree is not for the tree, is it? It's for you and me to partake of it. In other words, those around the tree are to take the fruit off and eat of it and to be nourished. You are to produce spiritual fruit, not for you or me. We're to produce spiritual fruit for everyone around us, that they can partake of that and enter into the blessing of life. So God gave us new life in Christ to be his spiritual fruit trees all around the world, wherever we are. Now, before we move to the actual short parable Jesus was about to teach, let's make note of the fact that right here in the text is a real serious mystery. You might say, mystery? Yeah, that's a mystery here. The mystery is the secret interaction of the divine nature of God with the human nature of Jesus. How were those two put together? How did they interact? And what did they do? It's really important because remember, as Jesus was walking from the road of Bethany, he looked in the distance and he saw this tree that was full of leaves. But if he is the divine God with the omniscience of omniscience, omnipresence, and omnipotence of God, those are the non-communicable attributes of God, which he had, he would have known there was no fruit on there, right? Why did he have to go up to that tree and look at it to see if there's fruit? Because that was his humanity. And that's important here. And the secret interaction is there. And what does it mean here? Well, it tells us about the divine humiliation of God when he took on humanity. What did he do with his divine nature? Did he park it in heaven? The answer is no. But nonetheless, the Word of God tells us that that divine nature of God was still with Jesus. Let me give you some scripture here. Take a look. Matthew 17, 27. Jesus said, "Go to the lake and throw out your line. Take the first fish you catch, open its mouth, and you will find a 4-drachma coin. Take it and give it to them for my tax and yours." How did Jesus know that that fish had swallowed the coin? The answer is by his omniscience. John 1, 47 to 48. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching him, he said, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael said. And Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree," excuse me, "before Philip called you." Way in the distance, Jesus knew Philip was sitting under that tree and was praying. So that's, again, his omniscience. But John 2, 24 and 25 seals it. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all people. And he did not need any testimony about mankind, for he knew what was in some people? No, in each person. So we see there is this divine interaction, entwinement of the divine nature of God and his human nature. So the Lord possessed the attributes that only God had of eternality. He claimed to exist before eternity in eternity past. He said, "Before Abraham was, I am." Omniscience, he claimed to be everywhere present. In Matthew 18, 20, he said, "Where two or three are gathered, there I am in the midst." How could he be in the midst of all unless he's divine? And so omniscience, he knew all things. Omnipotence, he just demonstrated that too in Matthew 28, 18. But nonetheless, Jesus Christ indeed is our God. Now, we're told how this divine nature and human nature were put together. For instance, in the book of Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, whoops, let me back up, I went too quickly there. "For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives" where? In bodily form. No doubt about it, Jesus Christ was God. He didn't become God, he was God before he ever entered the womb of Mary until the time he ever rose from the grave at the end of the crucifixion. Philippians 2:7 says something else though. He made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. In the Bible, theologically, it's called the kenosis of Christ. That's a Greek word. It means the emptying of Jesus Christ. He didn't empty himself of everything. How do we put this together? Two ways. He laid aside his visible glory. You could not see that. The glory of God. But what else did he do? he also took on the independent use of his divine nature. In other words, he only used that divine nature in his humanity when God the Father gave him permission to do it. So that's how we know this. So the attributes, his all-knowing, were available always to God the Father, but were not always available to the human nature of Jesus. Jesus had to go up to this fig tree and look under those leaves to see if there were figs there. And alas, he found nothing but leaves. But now this presented a great opportunity for an illustration to teach his disciples some last-minute truths. Now this brings us to what had happened when he saw no figs. Then he said to it, "May it never bear fruit again," or as the King James says, "May it never bear fruit forever." And immediately what happened? The tree withered. Now, this is the only judgment miracle in the Bible that Jesus performed. His cursing of the fig tree was a symbolic act. It wasn't, some have said, well, he was very vindictive, but no, this was not petty vindictiveness at all. Mm-hmm. Upon finding fruit, God the Son illustrated the truth in cursing the fig tree. The word curse, by the way, is not in the text. What is the word curse? It's an application by commentators. But what it really means, a pronounced judgment. Jesus, God the Son, pronounced the judgment on this tree. Why? Because the tree was not fulfilling the purpose for which it was created. And as a result of that, he took away its very existence and life. Now, Jesus spoke to the tree literally, and he said, "May no fruit, or may you never bear fruit again." Now, for those who are amillennialists, and if you know what an amillennialist is, those who don't believe that there's a millennial kingdom coming, they don't believe in a literal time when God is going to revive the Jewish nation from a remnant and put them back to life and bring them into the fullness of the promise of Abraham. They believe, the amillennialists, which is the majority of people in the present-day Christian world today, the amillennialist believes that God is through with Israel. God put them aside when they refused to accept Jesus. He has nothing more to do with them, and he stamped them into the earth, never to be revived. That's the amillennialist. And so God, in his great mercy, out of Israel, made the church. And the amillennialist believes all the blessings to Israel now belong to the church. The only problem with that is I wonder why the amillennialist never takes the curses against Israel and apply them to the church. Isn't it nice to just take here and there the nice things that are positive and put it to yourself? Well, God doesn't do that. The church is not Israel. Israel exists to this day as a remnant in the unsaved state. They refused their Messiah, and God had to put them aside. But being put aside is not to annihilate them. But using this text, "May you never bear fruit again," because Jesus applies, I'll tell you in a minute here, that the fruit tree is a picture of Israel. But again, you've got to go to the original text and understand the words that are there. And if you do that, you'll begin to see something there. Now, of course, with this action and the completed text, and I'll get into that in a moment, we now know that Jesus performed two acts of judgment. He cleansed the temple, because after walking the road, he went into Jerusalem, and he went into the temple, and he cursed the fig tree. Now, both acts, of course, were contrary to what we would understand about the usual ministry of Jesus. He was always out there doing good and helping people. But the Bible says he did not come to the earth to judge. He came to save. John 3:17, you know John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life." That's wonderful, isn't it? But we never quote the next verse, verse 17. And it says, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Jesus." But Jesus is going to be the judge of all the world when the end time comes. And he will cast into eternal lake of fire all those who have not received him as Lord and Savior. So, this act here, the cursing of the fig tree and the cleansing of the temple here, this was proof that Israel was a living hypocrisy for what God intended them to be, the nation of Israel. When Jesus went into the temple, remember last week, God saw that it had been turned into a money-making marketplace and a den of thieves was operating there. This was not what God had intended at all. And the nation of Israel, symbolized by the fig tree, was barren and without godly or spiritual fruit for which it was created to bear. So, just as the tree, Israel had inward corruption and outward fruitlessness, and they were stark evidences of Israel's hypocrisy and its sin. Now, also because of this, there was no early fruit on this particular tree. And Jesus said, and here's where I'm going to explain this, in the last verse there, may you never bear fruit again. We believe in what is called the verbal inspiration of the Word of God. What that means is in the original text, in the original language, in the original words, the sentence structure, the way God put this together, not only are the words inspired, but the structure of the words that are inspired. And so you must go to the original text to get the fullness of it. This is not an incorrect translation, but it is not a full translation. And the New International Version, the King James Version, most of them do not go and give you the fullness of it. And that's where the amillennialists will come in and say, well, here's proof that Israel will never be revived again, because it's a picture of Israel. But now, if you go to the Greek, you'll find that there's a phrase here, eston anon, and what it means is, may you never bear fruit to the end of the age. What age? The age of the church and Israel. God intends to raise up. God never contradicts his word, you see. Anon there, again, is meaning the word age. It's a period of time, a specific period of time that has a beginning and has an ending. And that's what's going to happen. God is going, of course, to bring Israel to life at a future date. But now, God's curse of this fig tree prefigures the future judgment which would fall on the nation of Israel when Jesus went to the cross and died there, which is only days away. And in addition here, it's talking about later on, in 70 AD, God the Father brought final judgment on the nation as far as how it operated, and removed and buried the temple and destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD. When was that going to come? About 20 to 30 years from the time Jesus spoke this. So we must remember that unbelieving Israel will not likewise be fruitless forever. And that's important here. They will bring forth much fruit in the millennial period and also prior to that in the tribulation period as well. So Jesus gives this illustration and performs this miracle as a parable to teach the disciples that fruitlessness is an important thing that God will in time bring judgment. But fruitfulness is what God is looking for in Israel, which was not there, and in the church, in all born-again believers. So ask yourself, are you a fruitful Christian, or are you just leaves? Do you just display some form of Christianity outwardly, a form of holiness or godliness on the outside? But within, there's nothing that's coming forth to help others to feed from you to find the goodness of God in the gospel and to nourish them to bring new life. So this is what a goal we need to work for. Now here's a question. This is rhetorical. That means you don't give me an answer. You answer yourself or you answer God. The question is, whom have you led to Jesus Christ since you were born? Is there no one in your life? That's a serious thing. But now I have to clarify that. Leading someone to Jesus Christ is the work of the Holy Spirit. Your job is not to bring people to new life. That's what the Holy Spirit does. Your job is to tell them about it. Now, they may listen to you or walk away, or they may ignore you. But nonetheless, if you are properly sharing the gospel with them, you get the credit in heaven as if they came to know Christ the Savior. So the question really should be clarified to say, how many people have you talked in your life about Jesus Christ and their salvation? That's what fruit is all about. Now, as hard as this is for us, this is the context of Jesus' illustration and judgment. The fig tree was barren, and yet it showed it was not. So God the Father, via the Son, of course, here, took its life from it as a judgment. Now, I have to say, of course, you know this, New Testament believers, God is never going to take your spiritual life from you. That's a gift from heaven that is yours forever and ever. You will go to heaven because the eternal life is not something you get when you go to heaven. It's something you get the moment you were saved. Now, I don't feel like I have eternal life. I'll tell you, with the arthritis, I was working on my travel trailer roof this week, and I was up there, and I want to know, once you know, my legs felt like molasses, my back felt like molasses, and normally I always lean on something to get up. Well, there's nothing on the roof to lean on to get up, you know, so I'm crawling around up there. I got the job done, but I know my frail humanity to the extreme with the arthritis and everything that's running around in my body there. But nonetheless, one day in the future, I will be in the presence of the Lord and all that will be gone forever and ever. But meanwhile, I'm still to be fruitful for the Lord Jesus. And God wants each and every one of us. Now, of course, the Apostle Paul understood that because, you know what? We need a dose of fear of the Lord in this area. Because if you're not fruitful and I'm not fruitful, God may well bring a judgment in your life, in this life. We call that temporal judgments. You know, the Apostle Paul knew about that. He wrote, "No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, if I've messed up and I've become lazy, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize." Paul was concerned about that. He didn't want to go to heaven as a disqualified believer. Do you want to go to heaven as a disqualified believer? How many want to go as a disqualified believer? Raise your hand. I don't think anyone would. Well, then get to work and be fruitful. That's what it's all about here. And if you don't, ask yourself, what's holding you back? Well, probably for many of us, it's probably a greater love for the things of the world than the things of Christ. And we need to reorient ourselves and take our cravings and desires for worldly things and turn them into spiritual things. Now, this text that we're working on is a troubling text, and I'm going to show you why right now. The text says in Matthew 21, early in the morning, as Jesus was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. We have no problem with that. And verse 19 says, immediately the tree was withered. All right? So in other words, the moment Jesus found no fruit, the tree was withered by the judgment of the Lord Jesus. That was Sunday morning. Now Mark talks about it, and he says the same thing in Mark 11, verse 12. The next day as they were leaving Bethany, that's the same thing, Jesus was hungry. All right? But now in verse 20, Mark writes, in the morning as they went along, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots. Well, wait a minute. Jesus saw the fig tree with leaves. And now from the distance, they see the fig tree is withered. Doesn't make sense, does it? Well, you have to understand what's happening here. Mark gives the probable chronology of events. This cursing of the fig tree and the disciples asking and seeing it were a two-day event. In other words, the next day, when they were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry. They went to the tree. They saw nothing but leaves on there. Jesus curses the fig tree. The fig tree instantly withers, and the disciples go on into Jerusalem. Now, we're going to get into what happened in Jerusalem. But for now, as the day was over, they came back out. They went back to Bethany, where they were camped, and they went back to Jerusalem again the next day. It's from Sunday morning to Monday morning. Now, as they walked by the same fig tree, guess what? They looked at it, and it was not only withered, it was yesterday, but now the roots were coming up out of it, and it was probably falling over from the weight of the dead leaves on it. And when they saw the fig tree and its withered condition, what does it say in Mark 11, 20? From the roots. This was the second day. So, how do we put that together in Matthew? Is one of them a mistake, an error? No. And think about this here because it's important that, nonetheless, Matthew simply telescoped, if we could use that term, the two incidents, and he used it in a literal and theologically way to impact the reader. He combined both events into one story. Didn't do anything wrong doing that. So he didn't contradict Mark, but Mark's story has the truth. So the second day, Jesus comments on the withered fig tree. Look what he says. Truly I tell you, if you have faith speaking to the disciples, do not doubt. They were looking at this withered fig tree. Now, not only can you do what was done to the fig tree, what I have done, Jesus said, but also you can say to this mountain, he was looking at the mountain ridge there, go throw yourself into the sea and it will be done. And if you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. Here Jesus is using this event to teach a lesson of faith to the disciples. He said if they had dynamic faith, as the Son of God had in his Father in heaven, they not only would be able to do miracles, such as the withering of the tree, but they would be able to actually move a mountain into the sea. Now, if they truly believed in the purpose and power of God working through them, they would receive whatever they asked for in prayer. You know, that's a promise of God to you and to me too. By contrast, the nation of Israel had failed to exercise such faith in their Messiah. And by contrast, therefore, they were rejected. Now, Jesus, understand this, obviously was talking figuratively. He never used his own power, nor did the apostles later on, to do miraculous works, to perform, say, spectacular feats using useless supernatural acts. They weren't in a carnival showing off in any way. And therefore, the phrase, go throw yourself into the sea, speaking to the mountain, was a metaphor. And it was commonly used, by the way, in other Jewish literature. So it's not a phrase that is taken literally. The idea Jesus was saying is, I want you to know that through faith in God's purpose and will, you being in alignment with God's will, if you are in alignment with God's will for the moment what God wants done, you can be the vehicle to bring it about. That's exactly what Jesus was saying here. However, there's always a qualifier, and unfortunately, I have to say it, our charismatic brethren miss this. You see, because they want to make God a great blessing machine in the sky. How do they do that? Well, they do that today by a new theology on the Christian world, which is called Word Faith Ministry. How many have heard about that? I'm sure you have, the Word Faith Ministry. But do you understand what it really is? The Word Faith Ministry is blasphemy. You know what blasphemy is, don't you? And I'm going to show you why. Men like Kenneth Hagin, Kenneth Copeland, Charles Capps, Robert Tilton, Frederick Casey Price, Benny Hinn, Paul Youngie Cho, John Avezzini, Marilyn Hickey, Morris Cirillo, T.L. Osborne, these are the names of the faith teachers. Jerry Seville, Joseph Prince, and Joel Osteen are a few of these new age, new movement within the professing Christianity. And there's five things that they teach that are dangerous, false teachings that Christians are following through, and I hope you don't fall into it. Number one, they teach that the human mind and tongue contains some kind of a supernatural ability and power. And they use this verse that I just quoted from Jesus. They say the very words that you speak can harness a divine force in heaven, and as a result of that, produce wealth and success and anything that you want in any way, even influence and control over other people and the environment. So according to these Word Faith teachers, God is obligated to automatically respond to accomplish and obey any literal words that you would utter in faith by believers knowing this truth. And if you don't believe me, I'm going to quote from these men in their writings or their works. Frederick Casey Price states this, quote, God has created the universe by speaking it into existence, and he has given the same ability to you in word form to perform. Can you imagine that? According to this teaching, God is reduced to some kind of a cosmic servant bellhop, whatever you want to call it, with formulas by the fallen creatures in this world who think that they sit on the throne of the universe. Let me tell you, it's totally wrong. Here's a second one, too. A second one taught by the Word Faith teachers is that every Word Faith believer is actually a God or a potential God. They believe that you and I are really a God class, and thus we become workers of supernatural ability just as Jesus did on the earth. Kenneth Hagin, senior, who's dead by the way now, and his son who teaches the same thing, says this, quote, man was created on terms of equality with God. He lives on terms equal with God. The believer is called Christ. That's who we are. We are Christ. And Charles Capp says, Adam was the exact duplication of God's kind. Morris Cirillo goes on, you're not looking at Morris Cirillo, you're looking at God. You're looking at Jesus. Robert Tilton said, the Spirit of God is upon me the same way the Spirit of God was upon the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but that's blasphemy in that Word Faith movement. That's not an isolated case, by the way, or a slip of the tongue. The Word Faith movement claims that you and I are little gods and that we can accomplish anything we want if we can say the right words. Here's the third thing. They say God gives his anointed teachers special revelations that reveal his ongoing teachers. Every word faith teacher claims that God still speaks to them personally by special revelation and gives them newly revealed truths. You know if that's true? All these places in my Bible in the back, you probably have them too, empty pages back there. Then you need to write down everything they say because that's the word of God. And it's as equal to what's written in here as well. Well, it's certainly not true. And it appears that every teacher in these, and I'm going to use the word cultic, new word faith movements, seem to be proclaiming a special revelation of God. Now, is there a new revelation from God today? Well, I'm going to let the Bible speak for itself. Revelation 20, excuse me, it should come on the screen. Revelation 22, verses 18 to 20. I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of the scroll. If anyone adds anything to them, God will add that person the plagues described in the scroll. And if anyone takes words away from the scroll of prophecy, God will take away from that person any share in the tree of life and in the holy city which are described in the scroll. He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The truth is, you and I have the final complete revelation of God right here. 66 books in the Bible. And there are no more to be added. There's not a single situation in life, not a single word God will speak to you. That is the divine revelation of God. The Bible is absolutely complete. The Bible is absolutely sufficient. And now, could God add to the Bible? Sure he can, but he's promised us he's not going to do that. He has no reason, biblically or theologically, and to believe that he's going to do so actually defies his very word. So the biblical point is God gives no new revelation. Here's a fourth false teaching that goes on. All sickness and poverty and lack of success is not God's will for believers. Word faith teachers say constantly they condemn believers who suffer any form of disease or deformity or poverty or failure in business or life because they say God wants you well and healthy. And if you're not in that situation, it's because you're not following the Lord. And it's a lack of faith or acceptance of their messages and teachings. Robert Tilton says this, Jesus came to deliver humanity from failure and to bring us all into full success. Kenneth Hagin says, Christians should have super prosperity and super success. There is no sickness or disease because they are of Satan. It is not the will of God for a Christian to ever be ill. Isn't that wonderful? Well, it's not in the Bible. Frederick Casey Price says, and I quote, God doesn't allow sickness in his home because he is banded through his power within him. Isn't that nice? He further states that's the reason he drives a new Rolls Royce every year, because he's following in the footsteps of Jesus. Here's number five, the last one. They believe that spirit guides are here to serve followers' requests and guide them into all truth. Now, many, not all, of the Word Faith Movement teachers I mentioned today teach that the angelic world is actually just waiting for you to speak commands of Word Faith so that they can bring these things into reality. They are there to do the bidding of positive confession commands. Gloria Copeland and Charles Capp say God revealed to them that they each have some 40,000 to 72,000 angels assigned to each one to do their bidding and follow their every faith command. Kenneth Hagin writes, turn your order in and send the ministering spirits out to get it by saying, go, ministering spirits, and cause the money to come. Is that really true? Joseph Prince writes, I give thanks to God for Brother Kenneth Hagin that we are able to see further into the Word of God today through him. Growing up, I learned a lot about faith from Brother Hagin, who truly has special revelations of faith from the Lord. I deeply honor and respect him for all that he has taught me. Word faith teachings at that. So the point is here, these charismatic teachings are false, and much of it is blasphemy, and we have to be very careful about that. So then, let's get back to the parable here, because Jesus was not teaching that you can move mountains by a certain command of faith. It had nothing to do with that at all. Let's put it into perspective. You know, in 1 Thessalonians 2:15 to 16, Paul talks about his ministry to the Jews that was finally and ultimately rejected. He says it was the Jews who killed the Lord Jesus, and the prophets also drove us out. They displease God and are hostile to everyone, and in their effort to keep us from speaking to the Gentiles so that they may be saved. And in this way, they are always heap up their sins to the limit. The wrath of God has come upon them at last. The wrath of God, of course, was the fact that God had set them aside, and blindness came to Israel. And that blindness is still with the nation of Israel and will not be lifted to the tribulation period. But God is patient and long-suffering with his people. And oh, there is a judgment of the wrath on them. It is going to be lifted one day in the future. So the fig tree, often in Scripture, is a symbol of Israel, a symbol of their biblical faithfulness that was missing. Although they displayed leaves, that they looked very holy to the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Now, Christ used this miracle as a tremendous lesson of faith, suggesting that it was Israel's chosen unbelief that brought about her deplorable state and judgment. So, if they would have just been fruitful, God would have blessed them. You know, the same is for you and me in the church. You and I are to be fruitful. Now, you might say, I don't know if I can produce the kind of fruit that the apostles did. That might be true, but there is a fruit that you and I can produce every day in our lives. Do you know what it is? Let me tell you. Galatians chapter 5, 22 to 23. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Can you produce that in your life? Yes, you can. But you know, so often Christians exhibit the opposite, and I'm the one who does this as well. Hatred, anger, jealousy, impatience, discontentment, a restless, unsatisfied life, a complaining and critical spirit, selfishness, even evil deeds, and complete faithlessness and unwillingness to trust God in some situation in your life. You ever go through that? Yeah, you have. I have too. But we have it right there. It's the Spirit of God who will allow you to produce that in your life. And what is that for? For you know it's that someone close to you or around you can partake of your love, can partake of your peace and your forbearance, can partake of your self-control and your goodness and your faithfulness. These are the things God says every believer is to apply. Now, in closing, let's put it all together. As we prepare to apply these things, I can't say this enough, and I want you to remember this. Jesus reaffirmed that true belief is confidence in God the Father and His will, that if you will align yourself with the will of God and ask anything of the Lord in that area, He's going to carry it out to glorify Himself. And remember, that's the qualifier. If there's anything that you will do by miraculous greatness, it's going to be that God will be glorified. Not me glorified, not you glorified, but only God. And those are the things that He is going to carry out. So Matthew 21, 21 to 22. Truly I tell you, if you have faith and do not doubt, it will be done. If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. So the qualifier is that. Is God going to be glorified by what you ask Him to do? All right, let's put this in application here. There's about four things. Number one, we rarely think of God as a God of judgment, don't we, in this life? But it's possible. Jesus illustrates for us that God does judge His saints in this life. So, is there anything in your life now that might warrant His judgment? We're talking about temporal judgments in this life, not eternity. If so, what are you to do? What am I to do? We're to repent of it, turn away from it in obedience to the Lord. Number two, Jesus made it clear that God requires of all who are called to be His children, they exhibit two spiritual facets of life in Christ. Number one, we're to be fruitful, we just talked about there, and we're to be faith-filled, believing God's great power to operate for His glory on the basis of what is pleasing to God. So ask yourself, how are you doing? Number three, there comes a time in life of God's children where habitual, willing unfaithfulness and disobedience will indeed bring temporal judgment. Don't think for a minute that God can't bring a judgment in your life or mine. You know, it's by the fear of the Lord men depart from evil. And that goes for the believer as well. So, do this very thing. It can become a permanent loss in your life if unfaithfulness and disobedience begins to characterize itself in your walk of faith. And lastly, number four, as a believer, you are God's spiritual fruit tree. Never lose sight of that. So what fruits are you bearing for others to pick and enjoy? So go to Galatians chapter 5, the fruit of the Spirit, and try to find some of those characteristics that you can allow someone to experience from your life. And you know what? God will be pleased if you do that. Now, that's what we need to do as believers in Christ. But you know, if someone's listening on the internet, and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can't display any fruit that is pleasing to God. Oh, you can go out and do good things in society, and God, in society, people will be glad and shake your hand. But God says they're useless. All the good things that Israel did were useless because they were not walking with God. So if you want to be in God's favor, you have to be in the favor of the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And He came to this earth to die for your sins. And if you will receive Him and put your trust and faith in Him alone, He will grant you the gift of eternal life. And with that, the Spirit of God will come live inside you. And He'll enable you to do these great and wonderful things that are pleasing to the Lord. And people will see the difference in your life. But if you choose not to, when you die without Christ, you'll perish for all eternity. So it's our prayer together that people will come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Is there anyone here who knows Jesus Christ as their Savior who's sorry you asked Him in? There never will be anyone, because there's no greater joy when Jesus comes into the heart and life and gives us the meaning of life to the fullness of it. And indeed, you and I can live it. Let's pray. Father God, thank You for the Word of God. And I pray that each and every one of us here, that we will be a fruitful tree for Jesus Christ. And I pray that we'll have so many fruits that are there for the plucking of others, that they might enjoy the goodness of God that led us to repentance. And I pray that if there's anyone who doesn't know Christ as their Savior, oh God, open their heart to see Jesus clearly, that He went to the cross, He died for their sins, and that You will forgive their sins if they'll put their hope and trust in Jesus Christ alone for that salvation. And turn their life over and say, Lord Jesus, come in and save me from my sins. Father, thank You for those blessings, and may they continue to abound through the Word today, we pray, in Christ's wonderful name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand as we close right now.